παρουσίαση που θα είναι πάνω στις πόλεις ως τόπους αντίστασης και ελπίδας.
Confronting them on a daily basis. that how could this system survive? And he said, we really don't quite know why it has survived, but we know how. And it has survived through the production of space. And this, I think, is a fundamental insight, which has actually not gained that much traction in contemporary bourgeois social sciences. I would be very surprised to pick up an economics textbook, for example, which would say the survival of capitalism depends upon the production of space. I suspect if anybody dared write such a thing in economics, they would be expelled from the discipline. Along with that, it's not only in conventional social sciences that insight has been ignored, but also in much of Marxian theory. And it's remained for a few sociologists initially working in and around Lefebvre, Manuel Castells, for example, and the radical geographers, there were many working in different countries who have attempted to push that insight. Because if capitalism has survived through the production of space, then this would say that any anti-capitalist struggle has to be focused on that process of production of space. And that aspect of it, which if you work backwards through the evolutionary sequence that Lefebvre spelled out, would say you have to confront the urban revolution, and you also have to confront the whole kind of question of the right to the city. And one of the things that I tried to do in Rebel City's book was to put those themes together as tightly as I could in order to be able to explicate both how capitalism has survived, but also on what anti-capitalist struggle must address. Now, the first part of the argument really rests upon making very clear how capitalism relies upon urbanization for its survival. Historically, there is a great deal of evidence which can be pieced together, but which is much neglected, which suggests that the dynamics of capitalism, which is always about expansion, always about surplus production, and always about surplus absorption, that dynamics has long rested on the absorption of capital surpluses through urbanization. There is a very nice statement about the United States, which came out recently. And I mention this because until recently, it was possible to argue that macroeconomic crises had distinctive origins in this phenomenon or that phenomenon. But it's very clear that the crisis of 2007, 2008, which continues to rumble around the world in specific ways, that crisis had its origins in housing markets. Not housing markets in general, but housing markets in the United States, to some degree Ireland, Spain, Britain. And even in the United States, it was not all housing markets in the United States, but specifically the housing markets of the southwest of the United States, Southern California, Nevada, Arizona, and also Florida and Georgia, and that it had therefore a distinctive geographical sectoral origin, which then had this huge impact upon the global economy. And for that reason, a few people, even in conventional circles, have started to look backwards to see what has happened in the relationship between urbanization, property development, infrastructural investments, and crisis formation and crisis resolution. And a San Francisco Federal Reserve Bank report recently put it this way, that the United States historically has got out of recessions by building houses and filling them with things. And this sounds a pretty silly thing to do, but actually, if you look very carefully, you'll see that there's a great truth behind this statement. But in the same way that it has got out of crises by building houses and filling them with things, so it has often got into crises by building too many houses and trying to fill them with too many things relative to the income streams of the people who are living in those environments. So the cyclical nature of housing booms and housing busts has become, I think, a bit of a focus of attention now in US academia. And one of the things that was uncovered by a series of reports that was done by the National Bureau of Economic Research, which is a center-right think tank, not a radical organization at all, was to go back and look at what happened during the 1920s in the United States. And what you saw in the United States was an incredible boom in property development, both housing and commercial property. Again, there were distinctive geographical focuses of these booms. Commercial property was almost entirely New York City and Chicago. Housing booms was really in peripheral regions of the US economy, with, interestingly enough, Florida being one of the great centers. Prices in Florida were going up at the rate of something like 200% per year for about 6 years. And it was in 1928, about 9 months before the big crash in the stock market of 1929, that the property market in the United States crashed. And these reports suggested that the onset of the Great Depression of the 1930s had largely been predicated upon this crash in the property markets at the end of the 1920s. This led, of course, to a collapse of demand for building materials, for new houses. It led to a collapse of property prices and land rents and housing rents. And that then spilled over into the stock market. So that there was a certain continuity between this boom of the 1920s and what happened in the 1930s. Now, the response of the 1930s was, I think, very interesting, because it was recognized as late as 1938, 9 years after the stock market crash, that the continuous depression, recession, in the property development market was at the center of the continuation of the Great Depression conditions. And therefore, towards the end of the 1930s, a whole set of reforms were set up, institutional reforms of the mortgage market, institutional reforms of housing finance and insurance, coupled with state-sponsored investment in physical infrastructures, such as the building of parkways and highways and the like. And that through these mechanisms which were set in place in the 1930s, the stage was then set for a significant reorganization of urbanization in the United States, which would then found the great boom in development which occurred after 1945. Because during the Second World War, the United States returned to full employment. It also massively increased its productive capacity. And there was a tremendous fear towards the middle of the 1940s as to what would happen in the United States after the war was over. How would all of that productive capacity be absorbed? How would it be absorbed in such a way as to generate relatively full employment? Because if all of those military personnel, well trained in the use of guns, returned from the Second World War and found themselves unemployed as they had been in the 1930s, there was a real fear in the 1940s of a revolutionary movement after World War II that would have been deeply threatening to the future of capitalist class power, if not to the future of capitalism itself. There were a couple of answers that the ruling classes at the time came upon. One was to attack all forms of left thinking as being absolutely un-American, as being traitorous. And so there was this repressive period called McCarthyism, which was an attack on all forms of left thought, all forms of left organization, which was deemed crucial because the Communist Party in the United States had emerged as a strong force in the 1930s. And during the 1940s, of course, the United States was in an alliance with the Communist Soviet Union, which posed, as it were, a serious political problem. But at the same time, the ruling classes understood that full employment and some co-optation of working class desires was absolutely essential. And in that, the reforms of the 1930s of the housing market became crucial. That in the 1940s, the rate of home ownership in the United States was less than 40%. By the time you get to 1960s, it is close to 65%. And at the height of the recent boom, it was as high as 70% in the United States. So home ownership was regarded as a great bulwark against social instability. Home ownership, it was said, would guarantee political stability. And in the 1930s discussions over the mortgage reform, there was a very, I think, interesting comment that said, debt-encumbered homeowners don't go on strike. And I think that that is, in fact, a very important insight. That by locking many working-class people, particularly unionized workers, into the capitalist system by home ownership, you gained consent, popular consent, for the continuation of capitalism. But that popular consent also had to rest upon building houses and filling them with things. And the way this was done was, of course, through the great boom of the 1950s and 1960s in the suburbanization of the United States. It was, in fact, suburbanization that got the United States out of the Great Depression of the 1930s. And it was a rebuilding of urban America along completely different lines. It had absorbed vast amounts of surplus, because it wasn't simply the house. There was the automobile. There were all the things that you filled those houses with: refrigerators, TV screens, all the rest of it. My favorite one is there was a boom in the manufacture of lawnmowers. All the suburbanites didn't have a collective lawnmower down the end of the street. Each one had to have their own lawnmower. And every Sunday morning, they went out and they went brrrr, mowing their lawns. So if you were very smart in 1945, you would have gone into business making lawnmowers. You had a fantastic market. Now, this suburbanized boom continued with some difficulties after the 1970s. But if you look at the rate of house building before 1940, on average it was around 500,000 new units were built a year, with considerable ups and downs. After 1945, it was in some years as high as 2 million units a year, and on average was about 1.5 million units a year from the 1945 until 2007. And in 2007, when the crash began, the rate of home building collapsed back to the level it was in the 1930s. Unemployment in the construction trades is parallel to what it was in 1938. The suburban solution, if you like, has run out in the United States. And so one of the big questions is, what will displace it? Actually, there are signs that it was already running out in the 1970s, 1980s. And therefore, there were various reconfigurations of urbanization involving the repopulation and reconfiguration of urban life in the central cities. And this also was a redesign of urban life that absorbed a great deal of surplus. Now, this theme, I think, is incredibly important today. Because if you look around the world and you say, where is there growth in the world? Where do you see high rates of growth? You see them in China. And what is China doing? China is building cities and trying to fill them, not with things, but with people. There are essentially empty cities being built in China, with a fabulous advertising campaign in the US press saying to people, we have an empty city, do you want to live somewhere? Come to Inner China. Now, China turned in an astonishing performance. Because of the collapse of US consumer markets, 2008, at the end of 2008, early 2009, China lost 30 million jobs in about 6 months. 30 million jobs. By the end of 2009, the International Labour Organization and the International Monetary Fund issued a report saying that the net job loss in China was 3 million. So somehow China had created 27 million jobs in 9 months. Don't you wish you could do something like that? How did they do it? Well, to begin with, unlike you, they had big budget surpluses. They had a lot of foreign exchange surpluses. So they decided to use all of those surpluses to launch a huge infrastructure and urbanization program. Furthermore, they turned to all of the banks in China and said, lend to all development projects you can possibly find. Now, if Obama goes to Goldman Sachs and says to Goldman Sachs, lend, Goldman Sachs just would say, what? Who are you? If you're a Chinese banker, you don't say that to the Central Committee of the Chinese Communist Party. You lend, and you lend fast, and you lend big. So China has this huge revival. Its growth rate dropped in 2008, 2009 to 6%, and then it was up to 12% by the end of the year. A huge boom. There's another country very close to you, which is about the second fastest growing country in the world right now, Turkey. You go to Turkey and you look at the construction going on in Turkey. It's phenomenal. Cranes everywhere. And I was on television in Turkey last week, and they asked me what I thought, and I said, well, it looks to me like Spain looked in 2005. So watch out. They have this huge project in Istanbul, another bridge across the Bosphorus, a whole new city to the north of Istanbul. Istanbul will contain 40 million people in 10 or 15 years. It's got 18 million already. This is the way in which Turkey is booming. But be careful, because in China there are many signs of overheating. You know, you're getting out of the crisis by doing this, but you're also getting into a crisis by doing this, unless you're extremely careful. So this process of urbanization and the connection to urbanization of capital accumulation is a very, very powerful force which is redefining what cities are about. It's redefining where people can live. It's displacing people. In Istanbul, massive displacements going on right now. It's displacing people, and it, of course, is changing the nature and qualities of daily life along lines which are defined by capital, not by people. And this process, of course, has been going on right throughout the history of capital accumulation and urbanization, and, of course, it has sparked resistance. So that the struggle over urbanization pits urban populations with their particular desires, wants, and needs against what is being driven by this logic of capital accumulation, which is accumulating at a compound rate. I mean, it's no accident that cities these days go through what Chicago went through over a generation. They go through it in 10 or 15 years. The pace of urbanization in China is much, much faster than it has ever been before. The pace of urbanization in Turkey. You see urbanization projects throughout Latin America, similar kind of thing. Countries which are also, by the way, growing quite rapidly. So, but this urbanization is not necessarily the kind of urbanization that meets social wants and needs. For example, in Spain, after the Guggenheim Museum came to Bilbao, almost every regional city in Spain decided it had to have its version of the Guggenheim Museum, some spectacular urban project, huge convention center, or I don't know, a theme park or something or other. And vast amounts of resources were put into every one of these projects, half of which now stand unfinished and empty, because they made absolutely no economic sense. It was simply absorption of surfaces in this way, and in a way which brought absolutely no benefit to populations needing affordable housing, to populations needing decent healthcare facilities or educational facilities. All the money was going on this kind of stuff, not for the well-being of the population. So then when you start to look at the other side of the coin and say, what is it that people want? What is the kind of urbanization that is really desired by the mass of the population as opposed to that group in the population that controls big money power, controls politics, controls the media and everything else? And here, of course, you find a whole array of urban social movements, urban struggles, many of which are very particular. Anti-gentrification movement here, sort of a pro-environment sustainability movement there, a movement against the enclosures of public spaces and the transformation into semi-private spaces, movements against big box stores coming in and replacing local retail businesses. So you start to see all of these movements. Now, what is very interesting is that these movements have had a very peculiar relation to the way in which the left, and in particular the Marxist left, has looked upon the dynamics of class struggle. Because ever since the 1850s, there's been a tendency in the Marxist left to concentrate on factory labor, and the factory as, if you like, the core of the political organization of an anti-capitalist movement. And the proletariat is defined very much in terms of a vanguard of factory workers, well-organized, unionized, powerful, who can actually transform the course of history. And at various historical moments, such populations have indeed played that role. And in some parts of the world, threaten to continue to play that role. But in many other parts of the world, that conception of the foundations of class struggle has become problematic. When I went to live in the city of Baltimore in 1969, the steelworks in the city employed something like 37,000 people. By the time you got to 1990, it employed 5,000 people producing the same amount of steel. About 2 months ago, it finally closed down. If you wanted to do something politically in Baltimore in 1969, you went and talked to the steel workers and a few other big unions like that. If they joined with you, it was a tremendous political force. By the time you get into the 1980s, they're no longer the same political force. Right now, they almost have no political power at all. Some municipal unions still do, but industrial unions, no. So my Marxist friends all get depressed. They say the proletariat has disappeared. There can be no, there's no vanguard. There can be no new history. So I say to them, well, you either go to China, where there is a proletariat of the sort that you like, or you change your conception of the proletariat. Who is the proletariat in a contemporary city? Who produces the city? Who are those people? And it's very interesting because you get into very strange discussions about, with Marxists, about the production of value. I point out to them that Marx says transportation is productive of value and surplus value. That That means every delivery truck driver in New York City is producing value and surplus value, and if you organize all of the truck drivers in New York City, you kill the city. You stop it dead. So instead of saying the problem is the factory workers have disappeared, go and organize the truck drivers. And they say, well, they're so difficult to organize. They don't work in a factory, they're on the streets, you know, they're driving around. And you say, well, what imagination do you have? And actually, the taxi drivers in New York are getting organized right now. And it is possible to organize the truck drivers, and by the way, truck driver strikes are extremely effective. Look at what happened in France in 1995, the transportation strike. Sometimes they've been effective on the wrong side, as they were in Chile back in 1972-73 against Allende. So get the truck drivers on your side. And then, by the way, Marx also includes, as productive laborers, all of those people who are actually maintaining the fixed capital. Now, in New York City, we have a lot of skyscrapers. And they're constantly requiring somebody to erect scaffolds and put them down again. I say they're all producing value and surplus value. So let's organize the scaffold brigands. So if we define the proletariat as all of those people who produce and reproduce urban life, you end up with a completely different definition of who it is has the power to change history. And if you then ask yourself, has that configuration of people ever risen up in revolt? And the answer is yes. Several times, the Paris Commune, obviously. But not only the Paris Commune. Turns out there are all these hidden histories. Cordoba, in 1969 in Argentina, essentially an urban uprising. There were urban uprisings in about 120 US cities in the 1960s. Recently, the urban uprisings in Bolivia have been startling. Cochabamba and El Alto. Those urban uprisings resulted in two presidents being forced to resign. They paved the way for Evo Morales to come to power. So actually, urban uprisings have not been uncommon. There was a Seattle general strike of 1919 that hardly anybody on the left knows about. In other words, that history has not been there, but even it turns out, when you look at the history of conventional class struggles, they were most successful when they unified people in the workplace with people in the neighborhoods. In the United States, the famous Flint sit-down strike in Michigan in 1937, General Motors. It survived because the neighborhood was there, the people outside, the gates. And you see small examples of that everywhere. The factories that were occupied in Argentina in the wake of the crash of 2001 and 2002. One of the great things they did was they not only were turned into cooperatives run by the workers, but the factories were turned into community centers of education and cultural events. So that the neighborhood and the factory distinction disappeared. And when the original owners come back and say, well, we want our factory back, or come and say, we're going to take all the machinery out of the factory now because it belongs to us, they can't do it because the whole town, city, turns out to stop them. And it is the unity which has been crucial all along. And it is still so. So my argument is that certainly, in those parts of the world that have been hit by deindustrialization, that those parts of the world have to start to think of the city not simply as a site of class struggle, because it's always been that, but as a subject of class struggle. That is, part of the aim of class struggle has to be to change urban life. And that struggle has to be articulated in class terms. So the anti-capitalist struggle focuses more clearly on the city. And that it does so in a way that combines many of those very specific struggles which we generally refer to as urban social movements. Now, nobody, I think, would underestimate some of the problems that arise with this. But in recent years, it's been noticeable that movements have arisen around, for example, the right to the city theme. Suddenly, the idea came back, and it did not come back because a few people like me started writing about it. I started thinking about it, and I discovered there was a whole movement in New York City that was called the Right to the City movement. It had nothing to do with me. I said, you know, my students said, oh, did you know there's a movement out there? And, you know, me being an academic, sitting in academia, I had no idea. And I said, well, what the hell's going on? So they tell me, well, you know, there's a movement out there, so we should get into alliance with them. So we spent quite a bit of time talking with the Right to the City groups within the city. And it's not only within the city. It's actually nationwide. There's a group in Los Angeles, a group in Chicago, a group in Washington, D.C., a group in Miami, all in the National Alliance. And there's another group that's got together, which I think is very interesting, called the Excluded Workers' Congress. And it's constituted by all of those workers who cannot unionize in any conventional way. It includes the restaurant workers. It includes the taxi drivers. It includes the domestic workers. It includes all of these groups in the population. And again, they're looking for a common platform. In other words, there is a growing recognition at many levels within the urban framework that a common platform for political activism is required. And phrases like the right to the city, excluded workers and so on, suddenly become very important. But of course, the idea of the right to the city is an empty signifier. Anybody can claim the right to the city, including, of course, construction companies, the wealthy, the well-endowed. In fact, in New York City, it's pretty clear who has the right to the city. We have a mayor of New York City who's a billionaire, who spent $2,000 a vote to get elected mayor last time around. $2,000 of his own money to get elected mayor. He has the right to the city. No question about it. I don't have the right to the city. And what has happened to New York City is that actually much of the city has been entirely taken over by extremely affluent classes. Manhattan has become the equivalent of one vast gated community for the rich and for the international, transnational capitalist class. Very cosmopolitan, of course, but as is pointed out, this is the cosmopolitanism of the frequent flyer, not the cosmopolitanism of the undocumented immigrant. And as a result of all of this, what we see is an incredible extraction of value going on in New York City as populations get displaced from prime locations, and surging inequality in the city. so that an examination of income tax returns for 2008 showed, and this was a year of serious downturn, that the average income of the top 1% in New York City was $3.57 million a year. Whereas 50% of the population of New York City was trying to live on less than $30,000 a year. How do you build a city around those levels of inequality? Where do the people who live less than $30,000 a year live? Well, I came into Kennedy Airport at 6 o'clock in the morning, and I got on the subway at 6:30 in the morning, and it was packed, mainly by women, but mainly by women of color, plainly exhausted, going into the city to wake the city up. And I had a fantasy, in exactly the same way in the Paris Commune, that the marginalized populations who'd been expelled from the city returned into the center of the city and said, "This is our city, and we are going to use it how we want, not how you want." I imagine one day, if that subway might carry all of those people into the center of the city, and they would suddenly refuse to make the coffee, refuse to clean the toilets, refuse to take care of the kids of the very affluent classes. What would happen? What would happen if they reclaimed their right to the city? Because plainly they do not have it right now. And what forms of organization could allow that to happen? And then, on that basis, is there a way in which you could start to move from this idea of reclaiming the right to the city to an idea of an urban revolution? That is, building a non-capitalistic city in the midst of this kind of ruinous process of urbanization, which is being propelled forward by the need to accumulate capital at an ever-compounding rate, by building ridiculous monuments to nothing and filling them with things. This seems to me to be part of a political agenda which is going to require us to rethink a lot of the categories which we've characteristically used to think about the dynamics of class struggle. But you know, it's time that Marxism stopped being conservative. It's time it started being flexible. Capitalism has survived to some degree by being flexible. And when a rigid force is confronted by a flexible movement, the rigid force is easily surrounded and dealt with. We have to start to develop a flexible Marxism, a flexible and very live political form of organization that has the capacity to move and be a real movement, a movement that moves, rather than a movement that just simply stays in place conceptually, physically, and politically. And we're beginning to see signs of that movement. This is, it seems to me, is the sort of things that was coming out in Syntagma Square when I was here last year. This is the kind of emotions that are to be seen in Madrid. These are some of the emotions that lay behind the Occupy Wall Street movement. But those movements have to be turned and translated into a political force. And while that's always an uncomfortable process, I think the rise of Syriza in this country is a portent of something potentially extremely significant, which is a movement that is prepared to proclaim its anti-capitalist credentials, and a movement that is prepared to really challenge particularly the neoliberal version of capitalism has come down to us. And it turns out there are many movements around the world that are doing that. The most successful, in my view, has been the Chilean students' movement. Occupied public universities for a whole year, fought street battles again and again and again over public education. And they clearly put it this way. Pinochet went some years ago. He's dead and gone. But Pinochetism is with us. But we want to get rid of Pinochetism. When the British Labour Party wakes up and decides it's going to get rid of Thatcherism instead of clinging to it by Blair, and when the US Democratic Party, if it ever possibly could, decides it's going to get rid of Reaganism rather than go with Bill Clinton, then it seems to me we'll be really going somewhere. But this cannot go anywhere without it actually having roots. And the roots, it seems to me, lie in the everyday discontent which surrounds us in urban settings, and which is about, cries out for remedies. And this, to me, seems to me, is where there is a great political opportunity. And I hope very much that we will be able to take it, grasp it, because this is a rather critical moment, it seems to me, in the history of capitalism. And as you are seeing, it's not ashamed right now to put on its barbaric face and act in a barbarous way. And I think that this is time, therefore, as Marx once put it, to tell the system to be gone, to make way for some alternative form of living and surviving that does not involve endless capital accumulation for the benefit of the rich, and endless penury and increasing misery for the mass of the population. Okay, thanks very much.